Hello, friends. Welcome to another episode of Engineering Today. And we're back again with some interesting updates for you. So let's start with Starship news. SpaceX booms ahead. SpaceX Starship tested their three Raptor engines at full throttle. Starship Serial Number 8, SN8, fired all three burners of Raptor engines on October 20th at 1:21 a.m. The test was much bigger than the 19th of October's pre-burner test. The thrust created by the stainless steel prototype was massive. Starship SN8, a first kind of that prototype, successfully completed and survived the first static fire test without any fail. SN8 will move for a high-altitude flight test if they succeeded in second triple Raptor static fire test with a stacked-up nose cone. Chris of NASASPACEFLIGHT tweeted today, "Starship SN8 and static fire, the first ever triple Raptor static fire. Mary documenting history again." SpaceX team built a new nose cone, which will be rolled to the launch pad for installation. It'll be fixed on top of the rocket for 15-kilometer flight test. SpaceX team made this nose cone with the help of steel rings attached a small windbreak. It also has forward flaps attached for smooth movement. Raptor engines, the most complex rocket engine system in the world, is a full-flow staged combustion system. It has to pass through many steps to convert liquid fuel into propulsion. On the 19th of October, early morning at 6:01 a.m., SpaceX team tested Starship SN8 for the first time. Pre-burners of Raptor engines have to produce gas at far higher pressures to account for energy losses as those gases wind their way through the engine's plumbing. So pre-burners may be the only stress system in an engine like Raptor. For the first time, SpaceX's Starship SN8 tested the firing of multi-engine Raptors, and this has often led SpaceX to test each engine's pre-burners individually before coming to the final test part. One big problem SpaceX has to fight with is that they have to convert supercooled liquid methane and oxygen into a hot gas almost immediately to run Raptor engines. In this stage, pre-burners are needed to heat up the gas. Now let's look into news which could have been a disaster. A Russian satellite and Chinese rocket with a combined mass of 2,800 kilograms were speeding towards each other in space. Fortunately, avoided their collision. According to a satellite tracking company, Leo Labs mentioned two large objects, which were moving towards each other, about to collide 991 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. Both were defunct, so there was no way to control them. The company tweeted, "This event continues to be very high risk and will likely stay this way through the time of closest approach." The two objects just avoided the collision for a 12-meter distance. However, there was no risk for Earthlings because of that distance, but the debris created from that collision could cause a risk to the astronauts in space. Leo Labs mentioned, "It's maybe a much bigger problem than a lot of people realize. Space debris is actually man-made objects roaming in space, no longer needed." According to an astronomer, Jonathan McDowell, the impact from their collision could have created the amount of debris that would be equal to 14 tons of TNT. If this turns into a collision, it's probably thousands to tens of thousands of new pieces of debris that's going to cause a headache for any satellite that's going out into the upper low Earth orbit, or even beyond, according to the CEO of Leo Labs, Dan Sepperly. However, astronomers are concerned about the growing amount of debris in space. Some countries like Russia and China have launched anti-satellite missiles, which are highly responsible for increasing the amount of debris in space. In 2019, India also successfully launched an anti-satellite weapon that created about 6,500 pieces of space debris. A European space agency previously calculated the amount of debris in Earth's orbit, which is about 128 million debris objects as of February 2020. Among them, 34,000 objects are greater than 10 centimeters. Each of those debris objects is very risky for in-orbit satellites as it travels at higher velocities. The debris problem will continue to grow as more and more satellites launch to space, a trend that's accelerating, thanks to continuing decreases in the costs of both launch and satellite development. and the problem could get out of hand, seriously threatening spaceflight and exploration activities if we don't start tackling it now. According to NASA, two events created 70% of orbital debris. The deliberate destruction of the Chinese Fengyang 1C spacecraft in 2007, and the accidental collision of an American and Russian spacecraft in 2009 alone have increased the large orbital debris population in low Earth orbit by approximately 70%, posing greater collision risks for spacecraft operating in low Earth orbit. Let's take a quick look at China's moon mission. China's Chang 4 mission recently achieved a prestigious international award for its accomplishments. Meanwhile, the spacecraft is ready for a 23rd lunar day on the moon. On January 3, 2019, China's Chang 4 mission, that includes a lander and a rover, first landed on the far side of the moon. Starting from that day, those two robots stayed on the moon for 648 days. Sending important scientific data and pictures from Von Karman Crater during local day. On lunar nights, both the rover and the lander go to hibernate for around 14 Earth days long. The mission caught the attention of the International Astronautical Federation, IAF, with its exploration on lunar ground and multiple science achievements. Thus, IAF decided to present the World Space Award to three of Chang 4's leaders at the 71st International Astronautical Congress 2020. Yu Dengyang, Sun Zhejiao, and Wu Weiren, along with the Deputy Designer-in-Chief of China's Lunar Exploration Program, Yu received the award for that mission. The World Space Award stands for remarkable efforts in space science, space technology, space medicine, and space law or space management. The team also delivered a lecture at the event online, which was held on Monday, October 12, 2020. At that event, Yu highlighted some breakthroughs that have a huge contribution for this mission. It marked the first continuous and reliable communication with the far side of the moon with the help of the Kaikeo satellite. This satellite orbits a special gravitationally stable point on the moon. From that, it continuously maintains a constant line of sight, thus enabling communications with both ground stations on Earth and the spacecraft on the far side of the moon. This mission also included many scientists and engineers in China. Germany, Sweden, the Netherlands, along with Saudi Arabia, made contributions for the payload, while Russia contributed for radioisotope batteries that kept the spacecraft warm during the deep cold of the lunar night. Argentina also helped with ground station support. Thus, these names are worth mentioning. Now, in our last segment, we'll cover a news story published in Russian reports regarding an air leak in the International Space Station. ISS cosmonauts are now at an advantage in their fight against the small air leak located in one of the sections of the International Space Station. A Russian report shows this small leak was disrupting the environment in ISS and slowly causing a risk for the astronauts up there. The leak was first noticed in September 2019, but at that time both NASA and Roscosmos did not pay much attention to that matter. Now, a year later, in August 2020, the leak has shown major activity rates in the orbital complex. As per NASA's announcement in August 2020, a few steps were taken to locate the actual place of the leak. Russian astronauts were checking in multiple sections to detect the spot. According to the agencies, those search steps included two crew weekend sleepovers at the Russian segment of ISS to separately check the components of the station. Up until now, the leak has not shown any sign of threat for the station or the astronauts. According to a report, cosmonauts on the space station have tracked down the actual point of the leak and tried to fix it on October 15th. The air leak was located in Zvezda module at the Russian compartment. Ivan Wagner, a Russian cosmonaut who's been living in the Zvezda module since April, called it a scratch. As per the information, the crew spotted the exact location of the leak by using a tea bag, although further detail about the process was not included in the report. The crew members tried to patch the leak, but as per a report from the Flight Mission Control on October 16th, suggested it might not hold the leak. During a communication with the Flight Control Center, a cosmonaut said, "The air pressure continues falling, although its drop rate has decreased." Some members suggested contacting their American colleagues, Chris Cassidy and Kate Rubens, for a different patch mechanism. "Perhaps we should try hard patches our partners have. We can talk with them. This is because the current patch is not so efficient," according to the cosmonauts. Apart from that, Roscosmos is now dealing with an issue with the oxygen supply system on the same Zvezda module. According to AFP, the oxygen supply system failed on Wednesday, October 14th. Three new crew members moved there before the incident, but it did not cause any threat to the members. Both issues are indicating that the International Space Station is slowly getting old, as it's been staffed for around 20 years now. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.